Hi, everybody. I'm Crandall.
I'm Mercy.
We are Armchair Directors.
And we have a Need for Speed.
So I got to see an advanced screening of the brand new movie Need for Speed.
And I'm jelly.
Starring Aaron Paul, his first post-Breaking Bad role. And if you've seen any of the trailers, you know that this looks like a Fast and Furious type movie. Yep. And definitely the best parts of this movie are the insane car action that is done all with practical effects. I don't think they used hardly any, if any, CGI in this movie. The racing is impressive. The stunts just blow you away when you're watching it, so you really get excited, you get into it. Aaron Paul is trying his best not to be Jesse Pinkman, and I think it was almost conscious. Never does his character ever say, yo, bitch. Okay. Lots of people say bitch.
good.
He does not. So he really takes a step back. He's a little bit... He's trying to be like a Steve McQueen type, which, of course, this movie borrows heavily from the classics like Bullet, Vanishing Point, which really made me excited as a fan of like these car movies. This movie pays loving homage to them in little moments here or there. It's definitely fun. The weak point of this movie is that with all these kind of movies, you've got a douchebag, you've got like a love interest, and then you've got like a moment of crisis where everything's not going right and people are upset. The douchebag in this movie is played by a guy named Dominic Cooper, who sucks. So he was Tony Stark's dad in Captain America, and he was actually good in that. But in this, he's just kind of got these dead eyes. And
I didn't think he was that good in Captain America because Tony Stark.
Right.
Howard Stark.
Yeah. So Dominic Cooper, weak link of this thing by a mile. Then we've got Aaron Paul as Toby Marshall, who's playing like a Steve McQueen, surrounded by a group of like wisecracking guys. And sometimes the balance between serious, gritty racing and the wisecracking sidekicks really doesn't quite mesh.
Yeah.
Because a lot of moments the humor does not play very well. And you're just sort of rolling your eyes like, oh my gosh, this is not like Ludacris or Tyrese in Fast and Furious. These characters aren't quite working.
Right.
But the stunts are so impressive that at least if you're a fan of that kind of stuff, you're going to like it. Overall, that stuff really works. But just be prepared that you're going to be rolling your eyes quite a bit. The person who steals the movie is a guy who's only in scenes by himself as kind of playing like a radio DJ sort of role. He's this guy who has a webcast and he runs a secret race, the De Leon, that you have to be invited to. Michael Keaton is back on screen.
Goddamn Batman.
You got it. As this fast-talking race guy who's mysterious and runs this elite race. And all of his scenes are played like basically the racing equivalent of Beetlejuice. He's just talking really fast and he's all over the place. And Keaton, every time he's on the screen, you're like, damn, it is good to have Michael Keaton back. So if you're a fan of Michael Keaton or a fan of Aaron Paul, there's going to be enough that you're going to have a good time.
So I didn't get to see it. I'm extremely excited to see this movie. The trailer looks fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
I love that usage of Michael Keaton that you described.
Yeah.
When you've got one huge star, and a lot of people might think that Aaron Paul is a big star, he's on his way up.
Yeah.
But movies like this need a legend.
They do.
And that sounds to me like the proper use of a legend. Isolate him. Make him all by himself. Build him up to be bigger than he actually even is.
Mm-hmm.
So that sounds cool to me. Aaron Paul, I loved him on Breaking Bad. I loved Breaking Bad.
Yeah.
Wasn't sure if he could carry a movie, but just from the trailer alone, those scenes show me that while he'll always have that boyish look about him, he can control his voice to have that grit in it and the gravel in it and the gravitas and the badassery in it.
Right.
So just from the trailer, like by the end of the trailer, I was convinced this guy can handle it. And just to hear that it's practical stunts makes me really excited, because the one movie I was really anticipating is Fury Road, return to practical effects, Road Warrior. And what's going on here? Like, there's other filmmakers in Hollywood who are beating the originator, George Miller,
right,
to the punch.
Yeah.
So Fast and the Furious used a lot of practical stunts. This movie, a bunch of other movies, they're going back to practical where there's real danger and it translates onto the screen.
Yeah, it's like a renaissance for real stunts, because we've become so just immune to the computer generated stuff, we don't get into it as much.
Like the transporter car flipping in midair and the hook, and the hook knocking the bomb off the bottom of it.
So that's one of the things that makes this really stand out is all the practical stunts. You feel the speed, you feel the danger, and that adds to the fun.
So I got to ask you, for the fans, the diehard fans of the video game series, how true is the movie to the game?
So in terms of video game adaptations, the Need for Speed series really didn't have much of a story. You know, you drive around, you race expensive exotic cars all over the place. So that's in this.
Okay.
They race exotic cars, and they do it on open roads. And
so as far as that,
it's Need for Speed.
This is a true adaptation, not a reimagining.
Right. I would say that's exactly it. You nailed it.
Okay. Well, that sounds awesome. I just love that the source material really has not much to it. Mm-hmm. Need for Speed being one of the franchises that didn't have an intricate, complicated storyline. So it's just a blank canvas, and it's going to be pretty much immune to fanboy haters saying, they changed everything.
They changed so much. They didn't have this car in it. They had this car, which is one of the things that, like, they've got some really cool cars, and I'm sure there's going to be people who love the game who say, my favorite car's not in here. But they got a lot of cool cars in here.
And I think the next game will have a story.
I'm pretty sure that they will have a game that follows sort of this movie and maybe this character, Toby Marshall. So, like I said, the acting overall is not bad. The villain's terrible. And some of the story is just going to have you really stretching credibility, but fun.
So, is it open for a sequel? I would imagine so.
It is. And even in the Q&A with the director and Aaron Paul, who were both there, they said the sequel is already in motion and things are going, so they're really counting their chickens before they hatch, but we'll see.
Cool. Awesome.
So that's Need for Speed. Check it out when it opens March 14th. Until next time.
Thanks a lot for watching.
And enjoy the show. Yeah, bitch, magnets!